Hello everyone, I'm Esther Marco, product specialist at Femtonics. We're manufacturing two-photon microscopes and we're dedicated to neuroscience. When a recent breakthrough study on interneurons was published in Neuron, to which we're proud to say that the Femto3D Atlas microscope has also contributed, we couldn't resist and asked one of the authors, Dr. Attila Losonczy, professor at Columbia University, for a short interview. The Losonczy Lab's goal is to establish links between the organization of neural networks and the behaviors they generate. But I will let him do the talking about the exciting research they are performing in their lab on a day-to-day basis. Welcome, Dr. Losonczy. Thanks for joining us today.
Well, thank you. Thank you for the opportunity to answer the questions and tell you about our research.
What exciting projects are you currently working on?
Overall direction of my lab is to understand the cellular and microcircuit dynamics supporting that learning and memory formation, focusing on the hippocampus and specifically the mammalian, the rodent hippocampus. So we use mouse as a model organism, and we've been using in vivo functional imaging, multiphoton imaging, for a couple of years now to monitor the activity of identified cells, identified microcircuits, and subcellular dynamics. So we'd like to understand how these computations that take place at the small scale or mesoscale can support that behavior. So we'd like to monitor the activity of several cells at the same time, several cell types, to kind of provide a systems level description of the neural dynamics. And on the other end of the spectrum in the lab, we try to zoom in to individual cells, their individual processes, dendrites, synapses, dendritic spines, the axonal projections, to understand the computations that take place at the microscale. So these are the two main directions in the lab, and for both we are using functional imaging and two-photon imaging in particular, the only way at the moment to resolve and identify these small compartments.
What was the main challenge you were facing during your research?
One outstanding limitations of the current technologies have been to observe and monitor many cells simultaneously, several interneuron types at the same time in the behaving animal. So that's been an outstanding question, whether we can look at and monitor their activity dynamics with a method that allow us to simultaneously monitor several cells at the same time, and at the same time also to identify them based on their established molecular markers and identities. So that's where the motivation came from, to provide a catalog, if you will, of inhibitory dynamics in the hippocampal circuit in the behaving animal.
Can you tell us more about the key results of the study and its impact on the neuroscience community, please?
Somewhat contentious issue, and it's been debated in the field whether or not these inhibitory cells show similar spatially tuned properties as the famous principal cell, the place cells that's been discovered 40 years ago and been awarded by Nobel Prize just a few years ago to John O'Keefe and the Mosers. So those cells were primarily thought to be principal excitatory cells, while the interneurons were considered as uniformly and homogeneously that active for most of the time. So our studies show that this is not always the case. There is a significant fraction of interneurons in the hippocampus that also have place-like properties, indicating that perhaps there is an intricate interaction between place cells that are principal excitatory cells and GABAergic cells, so they can influence each other within small microcircuits. So that's been one exciting result. The other exciting finding was that most of the interneurons, they active when the animal that is running around during locomotion. They increase their activity. That's been the rule of thumb, that interneuron activity follows that behavior in a way that these cells are activated during running. Surprisingly, we found that there is a subset of interneurons that they actually do completely the opposite. They silent when the animal is running around and running on the treadmill, and when the animal stops and sits quietly, the activity of these interneurons increases. So it's been a quite intriguing finding, and we would like to understand what it means, what's the purpose, what's the role of such a method in intriguing and anti-locomotion regulated activity. So we have other collaborative studies where we'd like to dissect this intriguing and interesting activity that pattern.
How did the Femto 3D Atlas microscope contribute to reaching your scientific goals?
The system allows us to scale up things and work much faster than we could do with another system. But just I give you one example in the present study, where we simultaneously image different types of interneurons to look at their interaction in the behaving animal. And that's been very difficult to do in the past, since these cells are occupy different layers. They are located in very different parts of the hippocampal subregion that we study. So we need the ability to rapidly move between these cells and to molecularly identify them, to look at their direct interactions, how the activity of one interneuron actually affects the activity of the other. So simultaneous large-scale imaging is required, and it's an absolute necessity to answer these type of questions.
What are the advantages of the Femto 3D Atlas microscope?
On one end, it allows us to monitor the activity of large number of cells that are distributed in a volume in a three-dimensional space, which is critical for recording activity in the cortex, in the mammalian brain throughout, where several cell types, including these interneurons that we are interested in, are distributed sparsely in the tissue. So using a single plane that imaging really limits the number of cells that we can simultaneously capture, and the ability of the scope to rapidly move the beam, the laser beam, and record activity from several cells quasi simultaneously is a real advantage. On the other hand, the other main advantage that we are hoping to use the microscope increasingly is to record from small structures in the brain, subcellular compartments, dendritic processes, axonal elements, individual synapses, perhaps, where we can also hope to do this in a three-dimensional volume to capture a large number of these subcellular processes that an individual cell has. Several dendrites, several hundreds or potentially thousands of synapses that we would like to simultaneously that record from, to get a more complex and complete picture of the subcellular dynamics of an individual neuron. And these are the capabilities of the microscope that we'd like to exploit increasingly to allow to monitor activity both at the network level and zooming in at the subcellular that level.
How do you use the Femto 3D Atlas microscope during your neuroscience research?
There is an impressive development over the past few years on the front of developing better and better voltage sensors. And once the development gets to the point that these sensors are ready for use, then the rate limiting factor will be the resolution and the speed, how fast and how well that we can record from these small compartments, in our case dendrites or dendritic spines or axons and the synaptic butons in the brain. So you require resolution, and that's why a multiphoton microscope is a must. And on the other hand, that you have to do it fast. So combining speed by keeping the resolution, that's one of the technological feats that the AOD microscope that can provide and enable us to do.
How do you benefit from the photostimulation related software developments?
We think and believe that this is an area where I think we're going to see really exciting results in the near future to use optogenetics now in a targeted way to stimulate or inhibit identified elements of the neural circuit. So we are excited about the possibility to develop the system and our system in particular here in the direction where we can carry out targeted two-photon stimulation of inhibition of identified cells or populations of cells or even subcellular compartments, since that would be a major step forward compared to that large-scale optogenetic that manipulation that are indiscriminately activate, stimulate or inhibit that neural circuit component. Here we could potentially do a really fine scale dissected that manipulation, potentially depending on the online activity that pattern of the that of the neurons.
How do you perceive the cooperation with Femtonics?
Yes, this is very important that we have a great working relationship with the company, and all requests of development or fine-tuning things, they are listened to, they are incorporated, and we have, a very useful working relationship and feedback with the company developers. In companies of this size, is I would say medium size, but I might be wrong. I think the great advantage that the users do matter a lot, and then they listen to the end user. They are, I think, eager to incorporate the feedback, and of course this is a specialized field, so there are several requests that are fairly unique to research projects. So there is no a one solution for all, so it requires really a close interaction between the company, their service, their developer team, and our lab. And also because of a complex system and a complex machinery, we all know that things sometimes they break, and all the systems break at some point. There are problems happen, and when it happens in overnight and in a Sunday night here during a critical experiment, this is ever more important to have a relationship when. That we can ask for emergency help, which happened not once but not twice, that we got service support after hours, overnight, and the problem was resolved so we could continue with our experiment. So these are, I think, features that not just me, but my whole lab greatly appreciates.
What are your goals for the upcoming years?
We think, and I hope, that in the next year or so we are getting close to actually harvest the results from many of these projects that require technological innovation. Among those was the one where we tried to establish large-scale imaging with the microscope. But in addition, we'd like to focus on imaging dendrites, imaging dendritic dynamics with genetically encoded voltage indicators, for which the microscope is also something that we'd like to use heavily. And then in another project, we are hoping to provide new information on how synaptically connected microcircuits of excitatory and inhibitory cells in the hippocampus now together they behave and support computation and behavior ultimately, since so far we mostly do it in isolation or in parallel, looking at large number of excitatory cells or large number now inhibitory cells. But now we are hoping that in the next year we hopefully finish a project where we can look at synaptically coupled excitatory inhibitory microcircuits and monitor their joint activity in the hippocampus.
Dr. Losonczy, thank you for your time. I wish you further success and many more groundbreaking results in neuroscience.
Thank you very much.